If you've had an encounter with Bigfoot, Sasquatch, Momo, the Grassman, or as he is also known, the King of the Forest, and if you'd like to have it shared on this channel, send me an email with all the details. You can send your email to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. I have been listening and reading the Bigfoot stories on your channel for quite some time. I love them. So, I thought it was time I shared my Buckeye Bigfoot encounter with you. This took place sometime between 2014 to 2016. I'm not completely sure of the year. Most likely, it was 2015, as you will read later. My husband and I were living in a condo at the time. We were across the valley, quite a few miles, 6 to 10 perhaps, from Cuyahoga Valley National Park. I have always thought that if God wanted to create a Bigfoot creature, he certainly would. Why not? And he would give Bigfoot the gifts that he needed to protect himself. Besides, our country is big. So many places to hide away from humans. So, because I was open to the Bigfoot possibility, my family would lovingly and jokingly give me a hard time about it. I even received as a gift my very own Bigfoot statue. Well, it's a small one made of concrete. Well, one day, and it was in the daytime, I was outside of our condo just on our deck, and I was walking along the side yard checking our flowers and plants. All of a sudden, I heard a howl, long and from far away. I stopped dead in my tracks and listened. It couldn't have been a human. They would not have been able to project their voice that far and for such a long period of time, and for me to still be able to hear so clearly from where I was. It was coming from the direction of the Cuyahoga Valley National Park, as the crow flies. I realized right away that it must be a Bigfoot. It couldn't be Bigfoot hunters or a howl on a megaphone. It was quite natural and pure in its sound. Plus, humans couldn't duplicate the depth of the sound, nor the intensity of the howl that I heard. Nor was it a coyote. The howl stopped. I was so excited. I immediately went to find my husband, or anyone, to tell them about it. No one but me was home or around. Darn, no witnesses again. After hearing the howl, I started doing some research on my own. Eventually, not the same day, I was surprised to discover the recording of Howl's CVMP in 2015. The howl I heard, however, was much stronger, louder, and longer than those on the attached recordings. So I am sending you two sound bites of howls. One is from CVMP 2015, which Bigfoot hunters recorded. The other was 1984 in Ohio. Well, my family may giggle at me and roll their eyes at me and say, "Sure, Mom, whatever you say." And they may think about getting me ready for the home. But I don't care. I know what I heard, and I know it was a Bigfoot. It couldn't have been anything else. I think they're just jealous because they didn't hear it. That's just their coping mechanism. Thank you for your channel. Just call me C from Summit County, Ohio. And for those of you curious, you can do a search on YouTube for CVNP 2015. The sound bites she gave me were actual files, so I really can't share them here because they come from another website. But you can go and you can listen to them. Thank you, C, from Summit County, for sharing those with us. I'm sure everyone will be interested. I live in Cherokee, North Carolina, just over the mountain from Gatlinburg, as we say. For our 10th anniversary, my husband splurged, and he rented a small cabin for us over near Fontana Lake. My mom kept the kids, and then we were off for a much-needed together time, which has been rare in our 10 years of marriage. The cabin was very nice, and the first day was great. The cabin had a flat porch that looked out over some hills, and if we looked hard and squinted, We could even see the lake when the sun hit it, but it was way off in the distance and over to the side. All around the cabin were very big trees. The only clearing was right around the cabin, which was on a hillside. Behind the cabin was trees, in front was clear so you could look out, and the road to the cabin was clear. Both sides of the cabin also had trees. First night, right out of the gate, we were sitting on that porch. They had these big chairs that sit low and lean back. I know there's a name for them, but gosh help me, I can't come up with it. Anyway, we sat out there having some beers and dealing with all the mosquitoes that were as big as dragons. Our view is straight ahead down the hillside slope, and it goes all the way across the hills and valleys. A couple more cabins were set along the hills, too, and sometimes you would hear a little bit from them, or you would see them every now and then. But mostly, it was very nice and private where we were. So we're sitting there, we're drinking some beers, and we were just saying how nice it was to be away from the kids for a bit. Don't get us wrong, we loved them, but time alone was few and far between for us in our 10 years of marriage. But the funny thing was, when we took our kids to my mom's house for the weekend, my stepbrother was there. He lived nearby, and he was there quite often. He was fixing their back door. He's a nice guy, I guess, but I'll just say I'm glad I didn't have to grow up in the same house with him. So he asks where we're heading and what the big deal was, because he knew we didn't have much money. To get away for a weekend was not something we hardly ever did. So we tell him where we're going and what the occasion was. He looks at us, shakes his head, and laughs, and he says, "You two will be Bigfoot's dinner before the weekend's over, I guarantee it." I just looked at him and said, "Ha, ha," in a flat tone like, "Very funny, dunce head." But on the drive to the lake and the cabin, me and my husband joked over and over with each other. It was Bigfoot this, Bigfoot that. "Oh, look, honey, there's a Bigfoot," I would say, and I would point to somewhere along the road as we drove by. We would both laugh. Now, as we're out there, we hear sounds like whole trees are being pushed over, and they're falling. That's what we heard as we sat there on the porch in the semi-darkness. We had a citronella candle that was lit on the little table between us, and there were strings of lights outside that we had plugged in, so we weren't completely in the dark out there. We heard all that noise, and I joked, "Oh, there's Bigfoot finally," and we both snickered and laughed. But it kept happening. This sounded like something very large was falling. This wasn't just a limb, and it wasn't something stepping through the woods. You would hear a strong, low, creaking sound, and then it would stop and bounce back and then creak again. It was just like something pushing and pushing on something really big, budging it hard, trying to make it fall, then backing up and reapplying pressure. After a couple times of that, it would suddenly cut loose, and you'd hear this huge fall, and there was a big whump, whump, whum. It sounded for all the world like it hit and bounced once or twice on the ground when it finally did fall. After hearing about the fourth one, we weren't joking anymore. I looked at my husband. I said, "Do you think we should go in?" And my husband just shook his head and looked at me and said, "Nah, it's no big deal." So I relaxed back into the chair and opened another beer. In fact, we each had one more beer right then. The whole evening, we had had maybe 4 beers each, and we're talking the space of 3 to 3.5 hours, so we'd also had a big meal before that in town. Point is, we were not drunk by any means. It was dark out now beyond the cabin. Out by where the trees were, far off in the distance, just beyond the clearing of the cabin in front, there was something moving around. We weren't sure what it was. Suddenly, my husband said, "Maybe we should go on in." He was poking me in his shoulder, and he was hinting that maybe it was time for some happy couple time. I know that's what he wanted, but I said, "Nah, I wanted to see what was out there." So we stayed put. Then from where something was moving around, a low moaning sound could be heard. We looked at each other like, what the heck? We live in a semi-wild area out on the edges of Cherokee, so we're no stranger to all the things that inhabit our region. But this sound was nothing that either of us had ever heard before. And I swear, by all the graves of all of my departed loved ones, that moaning sound, it started to change, and it almost sounded like someone was hurt, and they were asking for help. I heard L. Now, just read the letter L out real long and drawn out. That's what it sounded like. And from where we sat, it sounded like someone vaguely saying, help. I got out of the chair like I was going to go help them, but my husband stopped me. He just yelled out into the yard, is someone out there? Are you hurt? Do you need help? He said things like that several times in a row. Abruptly, the moaning stopped. It was total silence now. We stood for a few minutes waiting and listening. Everything had seemed sweet, romantic, and beautiful just a few moments ago out there, but now it all felt creepy, scary, ominous. Next thing, there was something walking across the grass out on the slope. It was just out of the sight of where we could see it. I thought it might be a person. I was squinting to see it in the darkness, but I just couldn't see it. You could only see that something was moving out there. And my eyes, they kept telling me what I was seeing was walking upright. But my eyes also kept trying to find the back legs or the front legs or the neck, like maybe it was a deer. At the same time, it sounded very heavy walking. It wasn't stepping light like maybe a deer would. Suddenly my husband says, let's go in. And then he's practically pulling me caveman style into the cabin. He shuts and locks the door and makes sure the other door and the sliding doors on the side are locked. The whole time he's telling me to go around and shut off all the lights. So I did. And now with all the inside lights out, we realized we still had the ones outside on. We couldn't turn those off. They were just strings of lights plugged together, and then you plugged them in or unplugged them at the socket on the front wall of the cabin. Well, we sure weren't going back out there. The whole time, I'm getting worried. I'm asking him what he thought was going on. He said it didn't really sound like an animal to him. He thought maybe it was someone out there and we were going to get robbed by one of those junkies you hear about living up in the mountains and the hills. And we had recently heard stories like that. They'll go up in the mountains and hills and take their drugs with them. They only come back down when they need a fix. But they'll steal from cabins they find or tents and scrounge around in garbages up there. And some of them, if they catch you out, they'll force you to give them your credit cards and things. Now, it's not happening all the time, but it has happened up there. And who are you going to call? Because how long will it take a police officer to get up to that end of the lake or that end of the mountain or up where you are, right? They know that. My husband said that, and I actually started to feel better. It made sense. It was a good explanation, I guess. Not something you really want to have happen, but inside the cabin, we felt pretty safe. And we did have cell phone reception up there, believe it or not. And we toyed around with calling the police, but we didn't because what were we going to report? Maybe we heard something out there? Maybe somebody was walking around? I mean, how silly does that sound? You go up in the mountains to get away from things, and you should expect that there could be wildlife or other things out there in the darkness. How silly would that call have been? Anyway, after a while, we did go to bed. It was cool enough that night, and normally we might have slept with the windows cracked for some air, but we didn't do that there. Now, we both had a really tough time getting to sleep, despite as exhausted as we were, and it seemed like every time one of us was just about to doze off, the other one was just sure they had heard something outside, and then we both would be awake again. Now, the next night, my husband wanted to sit up and sit outside again. I figured it was okay. I knew he had went and got the mace and some bear spray out of the car that day. I don't know why we hadn't brought it all in the day before. We hadn't brought in half the stuff from the Jeep. You know, you can overpack on these things, I guess. But the thing was, We had them with us now. Whether it was beast or man, we felt pretty sure it would drop anything out there. We also had taken some time that afternoon and looked all around the cabin and walked far into the trees all around. There were a lot of limbs down everywhere, and there were all kinds of things that maybe might have meant something, but they didn't mean anything to us because we didn't see how it all was the day before, so we don't know what happened during the night and what didn't. But we made sure we took a close look that afternoon, so if needed, we could compare it tomorrow. So again that night, we sit out there. Right after sundown, there's all these sounds like there are tree limbs being ripped right off the trees. It's different from the night before, mind you. Then, suddenly, there was no sound at all for a while. And we were just about to go in when my husband said he thought he saw something over there by our Jeep Patriot. Now, our Jeep was parked over on the gravel in front and to the side of the cabin, maybe 15-20 feet away on the diagonal. The lights from the strings outside lit the front hood of the Jeep up, and then the rest of it faded away into darkness. You could still vaguely see the outline of the back of the Jeep, but nothing beyond that. He no more than said that, and we both jumped because we saw the Jeep roll forward, then settle back, just like something had pushed it from behind, but because the emergency brake was on, it didn't roll anywhere. So there was something out there, all right. He was right. We both fully expected to see or hear a bear. We thought it would come walking out from behind the Jeep eventually. We had the bear spray ready and in hand, and also ready to go inside. My husband yelled out like he has done with other bears before. You know, if you scare a bear real good, like suddenly clang some pots and pans or something, they will usually take off just like you lit their rear ends on fire. So he's yelling something like, "You're not welcome here, go away," or something like that. When suddenly we both had a face full of dirt and gravel. It hit hard. It stung. My husband wears glasses, so nothing hit him right in the eyes. But I don't wear glasses, so I had an eyeful times two of it. It was very painful. I wasn't expecting it, and the gravel flew so fast at us, I never saw it coming in the darkness, so I didn't even squint or blink. I barely had enough time to process that something had hit me in the face when my husband was screaming, "Holy heck!" Then he's yelling at me, "Get inside! Get inside!" And he's pushing me roughly, but I couldn't see. My eyes were full of dirt and gravel dust and little pieces. My husband didn't mean to, but when he started pushing me, he pushed hard, and he literally pushed me so hard into the cabin wall right next to the door, I had a bloody nose. I didn't even know it happened when it happened. I didn't know what was happening at all. We got inside, and he suddenly locked all the doors down again. The whole time I'm standing there, asking what's going on. I couldn't see, and now I knew I had blood dripping from my nose. I could taste the blood also in my mouth. I was a mess. Then he saw what had happened to me and the shape that I was in. He was so sorry. He pulled me into the bathroom and he helped me get all cleaned up. I swear, I had grit in my eyes for the next 2 days, no matter how many times I flushed them out. It was terrible. At that moment, I was actually really pissed off about having stuff in my eyes and getting pushed like I did. But in my husband's defense, what he said as an explanation made sense. When he saw what he saw, and I will get to that, but when he saw it, he didn't know that I couldn't see. He thought that when he turned me around and pushed me, that I would see and aim for the door that was partway open. He also didn't think that he had pushed me that hard. But, as often happens with men, I don't think he realized his strength, especially in his panic. And honest, my husband is a good and kind man. Some people think he might have hurt me on purpose, but I tell you, he never has before, and he never has since. It really was an accident. If you could have seen how upset he was about that bloody nose. Anyway, I think it was just a reflexive thing to get me inside, to protect me, I think. My eyes are all still puffy swollen, and streaming with tears, even after we flush them out several times. He guides me to a chair and sits me down. Then he starts going from window to window again, looking out. Now, he might have been scared before, but right then, I knew he was acting like a kid who was excited about something. I kept asking him to please tell me what was going on. Some anniversary weekend, I thought. Here I sit with tears and swollen eyes and a bloody nose. That's got to take the cake for some kind of record for an anniversary, I thought. Then he drops this bomb on me. That gravel. It was thrown by a Bigfoot, he said. I think I literally said, get out of here. He said no. He figured it didn't like him yelling at it, and that after the gravel was thrown at us, he saw it half walk, half jog right out to where he could see it from the lights. It wasn't 6 feet from us on the porch. That's when he started pushing me inside aggressively. He said he thought it was coming right for us. Turns out it wasn't. It just walked from the back of the Jeep, closer to the porch, kind of on a diagonal towards the corner of the cabin, and it was very dark over there. He said he doesn't know where it went after that. The only thing we could think of is maybe it was trying to get in our Jeep. It was pushing it, maybe because we did have more snacks in the back that we just hadn't brought in that day. You know how it is when you're on vacation. You go to the store and you're hungry and you buy all the snacks that they have. But then you realize you don't need all of them. So we just left them in the car. We thought it was a good way to keep ourselves under control. The same went for the pound of fudge that I bought down in town. I bought that specifically to take back for the kids as a little treat. That was in there too. We stayed up again that night, talking and reading up on everything we could find on our phones about Bigfoot. That's actually when we came across your channel. We were looking for Bigfoot, Smoky Mountain, North Carolina, Bigfoot, Sasquatch, and all kinds of search strings. And somehow, we came across one of your stories tagged for the Great Smoky Mountains. And then, we saw you had all kinds of stuff about being in Gatlinburg. That caught my attention. You really want to hear the best part, Nance? This all happened the exact weekend you were in Gatlinburg this year in 2022. That's right, the same weekend we had all this happen. That's how we found you. Gatlinburg, Smoky Mountains, Bigfoot. And what do you know? We find Buckeye Bigfoot. Now, the next day was Sunday, and we were supposed to leave anyway. We were happy to do so. We packed, and we talked all the way home about everything that happened. But, you know, we had really talked it out, and we had both agreed it probably was a Bigfoot. Now, my husband was adamant because he saw it, and I trust him. He's never lied to me, so I think it really must have been that. He was too knowledgeable about what he saw. Now, first thing right off the bat, when we get in the door, my mom asks me, "Did y'all get any sleep this weekend?" And she winked at us. "No, Mom," I answered. "We didn't sleep a wink." I said it seriously. And of course, it was really the truth. Now, my mother thought it was from some happy adult time to the extreme. Little did she know, we had no adult happy time that whole weekend. You know, we're still talking about that weekend. Here it is, almost October, and all of it seems messed up, and we don't know why it happened. We have no answers. Now, we do tell people once we are comfortable with them, and we don't really broadcast it, though, to everyone openly. Although I guess you could say sending this in is as good as broadcasting it. But no one will know exactly who we are. So please, don't even use our first names. Cherokee is not a big place. Our jobs? Well, they're not the fancy career for life types or much in the way for jobs at all even, but they're all we have to keep us and the kids healthy and fed. So we have to be careful. People are real funny sometimes, you know? So just call us John and Jane Cabin. Well, we have one final comment tonight, and I think I might need some feedback from all of you on this one. Here's what Jeremy wrote. "Nance, K Can I please request that you do a short video based on all the stories you've heard and what you actually believe to be true, and maybe just your opinion? I know that you get a lot of stories emailed to you, and maybe you've met some of them out, but it would really be nice and comforting to hear your opinion on things with the Bigfoot Sasquatch subject. Thank you. What I believe on the Bigfoot Sasquatch subject, huh? Well, you know, that's a really, really big topic with numerous subtopics and subpoints, many of each which have their own subtopics and subpoints. So help me out here, not just Jeremy, but everybody listening. Are you interested in really hearing what I think is real and not real? Because I try really hard not to say or interject what I believe on a lot of these things. I try to allow that different things that maybe I don't believe in, that doesn't mean that they're not true. I try to allow everyone to have their own beliefs and thoughts. But if you really want to hear these things, leave me a comment below and I'll try to put something together for you all. I mean, tell me, are you wanting to know about portals or the paranormal or what they call the woo factor? Are you interested on what I think they are or why we don't find bones? Which is interesting because I just had a conversation with a friend named Dave this past weekend and he asked me, what were my thoughts on why there are never bones found? And we had an interesting little topic for a little bit. So, you know, if you guys are interested in stuff like that, I'm happy to start some dialogue. But bear in mind, I am no authority on anything. I'll never claim to be that. I am not a researcher. I have no credentials of any sort. I don't possess any degrees that could remotely translate into anything resembling a specialty relating to hominids, anthropology, or anything of that nature. I will never represent myself as such. I'm just a girl with a deep-seated interest. However, if you just want to talk to that girl with a deep-seated interest and find out what I think and let's chew some fat one night, well, I'm game for that. Anyway, can't wait to read your comments or emails. Also, real quick, I know a lot of you sent in some great fiction and all kinds of paranormal-style stories for Halloween. I do still have all of them. I have not been able to record them yet. But that isn't to say that I won't. I hope that I can find time real soon. You know, time just is running away from me this fall. I don't know what to think. I've got so much going on. And usually, here's the truth. Now that I'm no longer working full-time, it's crazy. I am actually busier than I think I was when I did work full-time. My life is fairly dull and serene and mostly predictable. But since about September 1st, everything is just, I don't know, kind of blown up on me with family and neighborly things and all kinds of things going on. So I'm just asking for patience and understanding. Also, we're getting ready to have major work done here at the house, and I may be without power for days to come. I really don't know. So if I barely post from a phone letting y'all know I'm MIA for a while, yeah, I might be staying at a hotel somewhere because we will have no electricity for a while, possibly. I really don't know how this is going to shake out. Just saying that, just in case. Anyway, you guys are fabulous. Thanks for your patience and understanding. I know all of us have faced a lot of difficult timelines and demands in our life. And, well, I'm looking at a really big wall of them before the holidays. It just helps knowing you guys are understanding and patient. Thank you so much. I never say that enough. All right. Well, that's going to close out another evening together. Until we meet up again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.